The palace looked charming, with beds, couches, fans, and seats all separately arranged in 7 stories. So Kardama Muni, by his mystic power, he has created a floating palace, as we have been reading. And now the opulence, or sorry, the grandeur of that palace is explained, how opulent it is. In subsequent verses, we'll see that it is created by Kardama Muni himself, but he himself is astonished by seeing that. So, yes, he is the creator by his own mystic power. He has the power and he can create, but still he is astonished to see such an opulent, you know, fabulous palace. So, in this purport, we see Prabhupada is giving some interesting information. It is understood from this verse that the castle had many stories. The words upari upari vinyasta indicate that skyscrapers are not newly invented. Even in those days, millions of years ago, the idea of building many storied houses was current. So, modern times we see people are very proud of, you know, these kind of inventions, advancement of science, but it is already there. Right. And this is millions of years. This is the time of Swayambhu Manu. Right now, Vyavasvat Manu is going on. So, we can understand how old. Right. So, it's already there. And there's nothing which is not given in the Shastra. And what is not given in the Shastra and it is present here in today's world, then that is mnemonic invention. Prabhupada says it is a nature, asuric nature, to invent something. Because for living opulently in this material world and for leaving this material world and going to Krishna Loka, everything is there in the scriptures. Beyond scriptures, if somebody is inventing, then it is a big trouble. Why? Because that invention happens through mind and intelligence contaminated by 4 defects. Tendency to commit mistakes, illusion, cheating propensity, and imperfect senses. So whatever a human being tries to invent on his own strength, on his own, intelligence, on his own capabilities, it is bound to be defective. So, whatever opulence, whatever material enjoyment is needed, that is already in the Shastra, it's already given. And moreover, the Shastra, whatever material opulence or material world or enjoyment we see, so Prabhupada says it is a perverted reflection of spiritual world. So eternally existing all these opulences, all these enjoyments are there in the spiritual world in pure form. So it is not a new experience for us. Only thing, we have forgotten that experience of spiritual world and come here to enjoy. But to enjoy here also safely, scriptures give that instruction. So going by scriptures does not deprive us of material enjoyment. Isn't it? Going by scriptures does not deprive us of material enjoyment. Plus, at the same time, it paves our path to eternal life. That is to the spiritual life or going back to Godhead. But the tendency of modern people is to invent on their own, because we have come here to imitate Supreme Lord. Supreme Lord is creator. Becoming creator gives us a feeling of being Lord. No, he is supreme creator, he is supreme maintainer, he is a supreme loving person. So when somebody gets into these moods, I have created, there is a feeling of being Lord or Lordship. When somebody gets into the mood of I am maintaining somebody, there is a mood of being Lord. Right? Or somebody, I am taking care, I am Suridham for so many people, then there is a feeling of being Lord. So we have come here to experience this, and that is what is entrapping us. But otherwise, scriptures have given all the direction, we have to just abide. Humbly, submissively go by the scriptural directions, you enjoy and be safe. But the moment we come to the mood of being Lord, right, then it is offensive, it is sinful, and then we suffer. So this kind of enjoyment is rajasic, tamasic. So coming to this, Prabhupada says that already these things are there. That enjoyment, that fulfillment of material desires is already there. And now we see that Kardama Muni has created this after creating this, he is also astonished. But very significantly it is written, he is astonished by his creation. He is not bewildered by his creation. Right? He is surprised. Oh, how amazing it has come up. But he is not bewildered. So what is the difference between this astonishment and bewilderment? He is astonished means he is surprised by what is there. Bewilder means he gets carried away and he decides, now I will live in this forever. But we see that Kardamuni, after fulfilling a purpose, he leaves that palace and goes. He takes sannyasa. Isn't it? So he is not bewildered by that opulence. And second point we see here, that such an opulent multi-storied flying castle has been created. This Kardamuni could have done earlier also and stayed. Oh, lot of hermit life I have lived. Now let me practice bhakti comfortably. That is also not there. He created only for a particular purpose on the request of his wife to fulfill that purpose of begetting children, and then he left. So he is very clear about why this castle has been created and what is the role in this castle, his role. And the moment that role is fulfilled of giving, you know, progeny or child to Mother Devahuti, he leaves. So this shows that he is not bewildered. Oh, now I can practice here also. There are people who can serve me well and help me in my devotional service. But no, he immediately leaves and goes. So this is the difference. Getting astonished is one thing. Getting bewildered is one thing. Bewilderment means other than Krishna conscious desire, another desire comes. So there is no such desire in him other than Krishna conscious desire. That's why he could very easily, conveniently leave and go. And it's not an ordinary castle, it's not an ordinary palace. Right? Like many kings leave their palace and go, it's a flying castle with so much of opulence. So, like this, there are many examples where devotees of the Lord who know the purpose of where they are, and it's very easy for them to give up. In first canto, there is a chapter called The Pandavas Retire Timely. If somebody has not read the chapter, and just read the title, and he contemplates over the title, The Pandavas Retire Timely. Why timely word has been put there? Isn't it? Timely means their time has come, and they retire, and they voluntarily retire. How and why? Because when they are in the palace, right, they fought so much. They killed their Dronacharya guru, they killed Pitama, who was so affectionate. They killed so many friends, relatives, and so many people. Yudhishthira Maharaj is lamenting. What he is lamenting about? Because of me, so many families got disturbed or, you know, destroyed, unsettled. So many children became orphans. So many women became widows. So many elderly parents lost their supporting son in this battle. So it has created a lot of trouble for these people. He is lamenting, and you know, so many personalities are convincing him also. So he fought so much, you know, and after that they attained the kingdom. But while in the kingdom, while in that, living in that palace, they are clear about the purpose. So as soon as time comes, Pandavas retire timely. Itni mehnat se mila hai, ab thoda aaram se raho. That's not the mood. Correct? For them, that winning the palace or kingdom, it's not winning the palace or kingdom actually, but whatever apparently visible, that they won Hastinapur, the kingdom of Hastinapur, that is also having a purpose, staying there is also having a purpose, and leaving is also having a purpose. So they are very clear all throughout, what is the purpose? So they are not bewildered by that opulence, and they don't continue to live there. That's why that word, Pandavas retired timely. As soon as their time came, we are also hearing in our online Bhagavatam class, the same chapter is going on. That without talking to anybody, without even saying bye-bye, goodbye to anybody, they just went, you know, so much detached. So this detachment doesn't come all of a sudden. You know, they were trained, they are Rajrishis, they are trained like this. Even though they are in the opulence, right, they know for what purpose we are in this palace, for what purpose we are ruling the kingdom, and for what purpose we have to go. All throughout they have the purpose of serving Krishna. So that's how they are not bewildered. Right? Like that we see even Sudama Vipra, he got such a big opulent palace. He was astonished when he reached his village and he saw in the place of his hut, there was a palatial mansion and you know, very opulent, so many servants and so much you know, beauty is there, like we are reading here, similar kind of beauty. So he is astonished, but he is not bewildered. Even in that opulence, he knows what is the purpose. First of all, when he went to Krishna, he didn't ask for it. Right? Krishna understood the desire. He understood that he doesn't have even desire to ask, but he has been sent. So Krishna understood his purpose of coming, even though Sudama Vipra did not express. Right? Because he was fixed in whatever situation I am in, my purpose is to serve Krishna. So this is external, this is material, and this is temporary. Today it is there, tomorrow it will not be there. But my eternal religion, my eternal duty is to serve Krishna. So being in this opulence and not getting bewildered, right? This is one very significant thing we see. And even Prabhupada gives example of Lord Shiva also. So many examples are there in Bhagavatam. Prabhupada says that Lord Shiva is the master or controller of Durga, and Durga is bestowing enormous opulence on people in this material world. Right? Whatever material opulence is there is bestowed upon by Devi Durga. And his husband of Durga. But still he has not even asked or even not got a house constructed for himself. He stays underneath a tree. What is he absorbed in? What is his purpose of wherever he is? If we read from Bhagavatam, he is constantly meditating upon Supreme Lord. You know, he is in Samadhi. He is meditating upon Lord Sankarsan. And he is constantly doing Krishna Katha. There are sages, there are celestial beings assembled around him. And he is doing Krishna Katha. Right? He is constantly engaged in Hari Bhajan. So, whether, you know, like Pandavas are in opulent state, whether Lord Shiva is in underneath a tree or Vyasadeva is underneath a tree, that purpose is very clear. So, this point of astonishment and bewilderment, that is that difference. So, astonished, oh, so nice. Bewildered means, now I got enamored by that, captured by that. I want to enjoy it. That tendency of enjoying is not there. That enjoyment is bewilderment. Right? So, when this identity, once identity is very clear, that why we are here, for what purpose we are here, you know, what is our real existence for, then one can be saved from this bewilderment. And one can be saved from this bewilderment. Sometimes people say in Bhagavad Gita, there are so many contradictory things mentioned. What are those contradictions? In second chapter, Lord says to Arjuna that if you do not fight, Lord says to Arjuna that if you do not fight, if however you do not fight this religious war, then you will certainly incur sins for neglecting your duties and thus lose your reputation as a fighter. People will always speak of your infamy, and for one who has been honored, dishonor is worse than death. So here Lord is telling to Arjuna, dishonor is worse than death. So you worry, you should be concerned about your honor. Isn't it? Here Lord says, you should be concerned about your honor. It is situation worse than death, more painful than death. But same in the same chapter, second chapter, if you read further, then Tulya Ninda Stuti Moni, there is no bewilderment by man upman. You know, whether people honor you or dishonor you are not bewildered. Whether Stuti is there or Ninda is there, you are not bewildered. So discourse of 48 minutes, Lord has said this also, Lord has said that also, to same person, in the same battlefield, same situation. So, very nicely Prabhupada explains that this starts with considering your duty as a Kshatriya. So, first Lord is telling to Arjuna, considering your duty as a Kshatriya. If you identify yourself as a Kshatriya, then you should fight. Then you should consider your honor dishonor. Then you will get kingdom of heaven. You will get kingdom of earth. And after dying, you will reach heaven. So if you consider yourself as a Kshatriya, all these things are there. But immediately Lord says, these are all duality. Honor, dishonor, winning, losing, getting kingdom or not getting kingdom. This is all duality. Then further, right here he says, considering your specific duty as a Kshatriya. So, first Lord is giving Arjuna an identity of being Kshatriya. That you identify yourself as a Kshatriya. Then you should fight. right? You should know that there is no better engagement for you than fighting on religious principles. And so there is no need for hesitation. So you identify yourself as a Kshatriya, and then you have to do all these things. But these are all duality. Then later Lord says, Traigunya Vishya Veda. So Kshatriya is in Rajogun, Vedas talk about Sattvagun, Rajogun, Tamogun, Traigunya Vishya. So Vedas will talk about all these things. Traigunya Vishya Veda, Nistraigun Bhavarjuna, Nirdvando. These are all dualities. Whether you are in Brahmana stage, Sattvagun, there is duality of good, bad, right, wrong. Whether you are in a Kshatriya stage of Rajogun, there is duality of good, bad, right, wrong. Whether you are in Vaishya or Shudra stage, mix or Tamogun, whatever, there is duality. Now he says, there is another identity that you have got. What is the identity? Nirdvando Nitya Sattvasto Niryogakshamo Atmavan. Beyond Kshatriya identity, you have another identity of being an eternal soul. Aspire for that self-realization. So there are two identities Lord is telling. One is material identity, which is temporary and full of duality. Another is the eternal identity, which is absolute. And then from there, Lord starts talking about how to act as a Atmavan or Atmaparayan, self-realized person, or how to attain that self-realization. So like this, Lord fixes Arjuna that this is your identity. You have to work in this. Then Lord further says that working in this, Duren hi avaram karma, Buddhi Yoga Dhananjaya, Buddho Sharanam Anvicha Kripana Phalhetava. So, like when we see, when we are talking about these personalities from Bhagavatam who are in opulent life, but they are not bewildered. Why they are not bewildered? Because they have understood Lord's instruction of Duren hi avaram karma. Right? Even though they are in this material opulence, it is not meant for enjoying the results or enjoying the fruits. Right? It is meant for serving the Lord. So immediately Lord says there, Duren hi avaram karma, Buddhi Yoga Dhananjaya, Buddho Sharanam Anvicha Kripana Phalhetava. So rid yourself of this fruitive mentality, this fruitive action. O Dhananjaya, rid yourself of all fruitive activities by devotional service and surrender fully to that consciousness. So here Lord uses the word surrender fully to that consciousness. In Kshatriya duty, Lord is not saying you surrender yourself to that consciousness. Right? There he says, you give up. Vedas will talk about this. Your real identity is of being a, spirit soul and serving the Lord. So surrender fully to that consciousness. Those who want to enjoy the fruits of their work are misers. So you identify yourself as Kshatriya and act as a Kshatriya. What is the result? You'll enjoy. Right? There will be enjoyment for you. So that is one kind of allurement. But then Lord says you identify yourself as a spirit soul and act as a spirit soul. How to act? Give up that enjoyment tendency and work in devotional conception of life. You know, in devotional consciousness. A man engaged in devotional service rids himself of both good and bad actions even in this life. Therefore strive for yoga Arjuna, which is the art of all work. And then further, the wise engaged in devotional service take refuge in the Lord and free themselves from the cycle of birth and death by renouncing the fruits of action in the material world. In this way, they can attain the state beyond all miseries. So this is the state, or this is the consciousness that we see these great personalities, they have. So even though they are amidst such opulence, Pandavas retired timely. The moment their time came, they knew that now the service to Lord has to be done in another mode. Right? When they are in the palace, they have to rule and make the kingdom Krishna conscious. When the time comes, they go and they know that is someone's service, dharma sansthapanartha. They are doing their service in the palace. When the time has come, they leave and they serve by fixing their mind fully on Krishna and going back to Godhead. So in either case, their purpose is to serve the Lord. So they are not bewildered. Right? And this is what Lord is telling. Ki in either case, wherever you are, rid yourself of this fruitive mentality. The moment we have enjoyment mentality, the object which gives us enjoyment, we get attached to that. And then there is a tendency of forgetting Krishna. This is what Narad Muni is telling to Vyasadeva also. That you are giving devotional service in the scriptures through some allurement of material benefit. You do this, you will get this benefit. You do that, you will get that benefit. So you render some devotional service, you follow some Shastric principles, you will get different kinds of benefits. But the flaw or you know, the danger in this prescription is, if somebody gets a chance to enjoy without following the procedure, without following the devotional practice, he will immediately go for that. Say, sometimes we tell children, you know, you would have seen, even in our childhood it would have happened. You do homework, I'll give you chocolate. You know, you finish this much study, I'll give you chocolate. Or I'll give you something. Or you get these many marks in exam, I'll give you, you know, some gift, some cycle, something, whatever. You know, some kind of gift. So, to attain that fruit, his meditation will be on the fruit. Right, first thing. His meditation will be on the fruit. Mujhe fruit chahiye, I want that. I want that result. I want that benefit. So he'll work. But if say suddenly some guest comes, some uncle comes, some auntie comes, grandfather comes. Oh, you want cycle? I'll give you cycle, take. Why will you study if cycle is coming directly without studying? So if somebody finds a shortcut way to enjoy, then he will not take this tedious or, you know, this procedural way of Shastra to enjoy and purify. You know, that procedural way of purification and then attain the result. If I have to study so much and get one chocolate, and my uncle is giving chocolate free of cost, you know, just uncle out of it, what are yellow chocolate? Why should I study? No, I wanted chocolate. I didn't want education. Yes or no? Education my father wanted. Beta pado. He wanted. I didn't want. Right? I wanted chocolate. Now I'm getting. So why should study? If you don't study, I'll not give you chocolate. Don't give. I'm getting from elsewhere. So this is the danger. So same way, Narad Muni is pointing out that you are alluring people for material benefit. The moment, two dangers. One is getting attached to material benefit, and second, the moment they get another bypass way to attain this, they'll not follow this, you know, purificatory process. So this is what the danger Lord is also telling to Arjuna, that you are following this Shastric way of Trigunna Visha Veda. Yes, it is Shastric way. It is meant to eventually purify. But danger is you get attached to this fruity mentality, you forget the purpose, or the purpose becomes secondary, then bewilderment comes. Right? Then bewilderment comes. So very vigilantly one has to keep focus on what is the purpose. So by regularly hearing, by association of devotees, you know, by practicing our sadhana process, instructions given by Prabhu, by doing Prabhupada and by doing the service. You know, assigned to us, prescribed service, assigned service, authorized assigned service, then this purpose remains clear in our head. Right? Then this bewilderment will not come. So, same way, right? If we stand outside here in the garden, somebody comes, you know, we talk to some newcomer, aap kahan rehte ho? Hum yahan rehte hain. You know, you show behind you there, this temple is there. Oh, like that they have. You know, sometimes people come to temple hall. If you stand in temple hall on a regular day, you know, some newcomer comes, no? They say, wow, it's like a swarg. Sometimes, two, three times I've heard people exclaiming, oh, itum swarg jaisa hai. So I used to think, inhone swarg kab dekha hoga? In this life, they have not seen swarg. In past life, they would have seen Krishna. Erase that memory, isn't it? So how do they know it was looking like swarg? Right? Anyway, but in TV or, you know, in movies, they depict swarg like this, opulent. And we hear and read also, swarg is very opulent. So they feel like that. So they get bewildered. And sometimes people say, jo yahan rehte honge, kitna maza aata hoga. Isn't it? But we are also living here, you know. We are also living in, you know, such a kind of opulent, fabulous mansion of Lord Radha Madhav. But we know our role is of servant. We are servants. So when one is connected with the Supreme Lord, correct, Shastri. Shastri means equal opulence as Lord. At least the place where we are living, you know, we are living in same building, not also in same premises. That is Samipya. We are living in the, correct, we are living in the same, Samipya means nearby. Nearby is the temple and nearby is this thing. We are living in the same building. So what can be greater opulence? But immediately we all always are clear about the purpose. Isn't it? We are always clear about the purpose that we are serving here. Like people who live in Rashtrapati Bhavan. You know, Rashtrapati Bhavan has how many employees, you know? 545 people are taking care of the Rashtrapati Bhavan. All aspects, all put together. You know, all put together. 545. Like RTI has said that. You know, Right to Information Act, somebody has pulled out that data. So I thought 100, 200 will be there, 545. So they are also living in the same building as the president of India. Right? But they are very clear, I am driver, I am gardener, I am cook. There are 38 cooks. There are nearly 40 drivers, 100 plus are gardeners who are taking care. Like that some information is there. So they are very clear. There is only one president. We are living in the same building, same premise, but we are not presidents. Correct? The president rings a bell, immediately they have to run and attend to him. So same way, when we are here, we know there is only one president, Supreme Lord. We are in his, in his abode. You know, we are in his palace, in his temple, as servants. So this purpose, so what all activities we are doing? That is to serve the Lord. Serve the Lord for the Lord's pleasure. So when this idea is clear, when this concept is very clear, then astonishment will always be there that, oh, how fortunate we are. We are living in the same place with the Lord. You know, being a close, confidential associate, rendering personal service to the Lord. This astonishment will always be there. But the bewilderment will not be there. Getting bewildered and getting attached to this. Right? So the moment there is a change of service, there is a change of place, you know, immediately ready. Pandavas retired timely. Their role was for some time to be here and serve in this manner. The role got changed. They served in another manner. But nir yogakshayam atvan, I am eternal servant of Krishna. That idea, that concept, that conviction never shook. So same way Karna Muni is in the opulent palace now. Immediately his purpose of giving son to Mother Devahuti will be fulfilled and he will leave. And again he will serve the Lord in another way. He will take sannyasa and fully meditate, absorb, get into samadhi and go back to Godhead. So that purpose, you know, that is very clear in all aspects. So there is a verse which says that Narayana Parah Vyakta, you know, Kutaschanna Bibhyati. So whether in heaven, in hell, or in even Brahma Jyoti, Vaikuntha, wherever a devotee is, right, he has no fear, he has no bewilderment. All the places are Krishna's places. See, very interestingly, Krishna says in fifth chapter, the 29th verse, first line. Bhoktaram Yajna Tapsam Sarva Loka Maheshwaram. See, Sarva Loka Maheshwaram is very interesting. Sarva Loka Maheshwaram. Maheshwaram, Ishwaram means controller. Maheshwaram means supreme controller. Supreme controller of Sarva Loka. Loka, Prabhupada says Loka has two meanings. Loka means Lok, public. Correct? Jana Lok, like Lok we say. And Loka also means planets. So Krishna is supreme controller of all the planets in this universe. Krishna is supreme controller of all the living beings. So whether a devotee is in heaven or in hell, That is also planet. In all places, all planets, Krishna's supreme control is there. There is no place where Krishna's control is not there. Oh, if I go to heaven, what will happen? Hell, what will happen? Right? When there was COVID epidemic, pandemic, it was there. So people are saying, where is Lord? You know, people are dying. So much of trouble is there. You know, there is so much of suffering. Lord is so helpless that he is not able to help. No, there is no place which is out of Krishna's control. This earthly planet is under Krishna's control, full control. Every atom is under Krishna's control. Hellish planets are under Krishna's control, heavenly planets are under Krishna's control. So there is no place which is not under Krishna's control. You are saying Krishna is helpless. But what if Krishna sent this to settle the world little, you know, to calm down the world little of sinful activities? So devotee knows everywhere there is Krishna's control. So he is not fearful, he is not bewildered. Oh, Krishna is in control, whether I go to heaven, I go to hell. And Krishna is control of all the living entities. So whoever comes, you know, to my interaction, whomever I interact with is under control of Krishna. He is not outside Krishna's control. So whatever happiness or distress somebody is giving is also under Krishna's control. So when somebody is situated in this, that's why Krishna says, then you will be peaceful. Oh, this is also happening by Krishna's will, that is also happening by Krishna's will. This is called Shanti Sutra or Peace Formula. So like that, devotee is fixed in purpose and is confident that whatever and wherever he is, it is under Krishna's control. So why should we be bewildered? Krishna is sanctioning this. Without his sanction, nothing can happen. Isn't it? So in this way, one can be fixed up without bewilderment. Right? So we'll stop here. Grantha Shyam Bhagavatam ki chai. Shri Prabhupada ki chai. Hare Krishna.